Good evening, everyone. Hi. So today we are gathered to for the our webinar, the series AOI Basics to Advanced Certificate Series. And today we have a very interesting topic. The first moderator is Dr. Pawan Singhal. He is a professor in SMS Medical College, as also past secretary of Neuro-Otology Society, and he is a gold medalist at MS. And he's earned a lot of fellowships, international traveling fellowship, as well as ISO fellowship, and visited a lot of centers around the world. Also, he's doing cochlear implant surgery, skull-based surgery, and endoscopic and microscopic ear surgery. So over to Pawan.
Thank you so much, Yogesh sir, for kind words. So good evening, everyone, especially the PG students. I would rather direct to, because the crux, the aim of these AOI lecture was to deliver a good knowledge, scientific knowledge, in a proper way to PG students and our consultant colleagues. So today I am very happy to introduce my teacher, Dr. Anita Bhandari. She was my teacher during my MS from SMS. Dr. Anita Bhandari ma'am did her MS in ENT from Rajasthan. Then she joined SMS Medical College as assistant professor. She was a thorough academician when she was there. We have a lot of common publications all together. Then she did her neuro-otology. She started with the neuro-otology practice, and she did her fellowship in neuro-otology and otology from Singapore. Then she started with her own vertigo and a specialized center of art vertigo clinic there in Jaipur itself. Then she again indulged herself in innovations in research of neurotology, and she has got three patents to her name in the field of neurotology, especially in virtual reality inclusion in field of vestibular rehabilitation. She has got more than 500 clinics there in India, in Southeast in Asia, in some African countries also. And she has recently delivered NES oration in one of the NES conference. She has got a lot of chapters there in books and a lot of publications in the field of neurotology. So she is a hardcore academician, a researcher in the field of neurotology. All to you, ma'am. Thank you.
So thank you so much, Dr. Pawan, for that kind introduction. And basically, whether I actually am worthy of your kind words, but I'd really like to thank you a lot. And so from a student, how you've grown up and made yourself as a key personality, a key speaker all over the world. I would also like to thank AOI for providing this unique opportunity to reach out to the ENT fraternity, not only in India, but all over the world, to share knowledge. It is indeed a privilege for me to be sharing the same platform as Dr. Anirban sir, who is my teacher. So I'd like to now start sharing my screen. And today I'll be talking about the physiology of the vestibular system, which is a key part of how we will be able to understand balance disorders. Now, balance disorders affect over 15% of the population, and it affects the quality of life of those patients. The balance system is actually the most complex system in the body, and a human-like walking robot could be made only a few years ago, when the technology for miniaturization of the of gyroscopes and accelerometers could be developed. But more importantly, this required a huge computation power. So the gyroscopes and accelerometers were sort of a miniaturization of the inner ear function, and the computation power required was from the basically equivalent to the CNS inputs to the system. Now, why we need to understand the vestibular physiology pathways is to understand the eye movement and balance behaviors to maintain the equilibrium, to find out what are the effects of dysfunction, why the symptoms may change with time or with therapeutic intervention. Only when we understand the baseline, the normal physiology, will we be able to interpret the test results. And finally, if there is a vestibular deficit, how the CNS is able to compensate for this deficit and be able to function to the best optimal requirement. So the inner ear is basically a motion sensor. And if we talk about the cochlea, it responds to high frequency movement in the form of sound waves. While the labyrinth responds to low frequencies in the form of body movements. So within the bony labyrinth lies the membranous labyrinth. And here you have the two components of the inner ear, the ducts or the semicircular canals, which are the slender ducts, and the other part are the sacs, the utricle and saccule, which form the otolith organs. The semicircular canal is responsible for detection of angular acceleration, while the linear acceleration and gravity is detected by the otolith. Now, the important word here is acceleration. So these sensors can respond only to a change of velocity. It has to be acceleration or deacceleration. It does not respond to a constant velocity. So if you take the analogy of maybe when we travel in a plane, the takeoff and the landing are when we actually feel the motion the most. But when the plane is at a cruising speed, we stop feeling the movement. Now, why do we have these two sense organs? So two eyes or two visual organs are for stereo vision. That means in the three dimensions to understand depth of the visual field. We have our two audio organs to be able to decipher directionality, the spatial perception. And similarly, we have two labyrinths. This is for us to be able to detect from very small to very large accelerations in all directions. So we have a large dynamic range for this. And this allows us to detect motion in the 3D, in the three dimensions. Now let us talk about the semicircular canals first. So the three semicircular canals are basically slender ducts, and one side called the ampulla is the dilated portion. This ampulla houses the sensory organ called the crista ampullaris. These sensory organs have hair cells, and above the hair cells is a gelatinous matrix called the cupula, which crosses the whole diameter of the ampulla, providing a barrier. So when I talk about the hair cells, each hair cell is like a goblet-shaped cell, which has the tallest hair cell called the kinocelium, along with smaller fibrils called the stereocilia. These stereocilia and kinocelia are connected at the top with tip links. So in the form of sort of a rubber band, they all are oriented in the same direction. And if there is movement, all of them move together. So all the hair cells in an ampulla will have the same directional orientation, and this facilitates synchronous firing of the axons. Now what happens when the stereocilia bends towards the kinocelium? So because of the bending, there is stretching or opening up of the tip links, which allows the potassium channels present there to open and have a potassium ion influx. So this causes a depolarization of the hair cell and further facilitates the opening of the calcium channels. So with the calcium influx, the presynaptic vesicles, which are filled with the neurotransmitter, fuse with the surface membrane and release the neurotransmitter, basically glutamate, at the synapses. So this causes a increase in the action potential. So we can say that depolarization causes an excitation of the nerve fibers. The reverse happens when the stereocilia bend away from the kinocilium. So because of the bending, there is now a closing of the potassium channels. There is no entry of potassium ions, leading to a hyperpolarization of the cells. The calcium channels close as well. And now, because of that, the vesicles do not release the neurotransmitter into the synapse. So there is a reduced release of the neurotransmitter, and hence we can say hyperpolarization results in inhibition of the hair cells. So you can just look at this, quickly recap: movement towards the kinocelium, excitation, movement away, hyperpolarization, and inhibition. So this is Ewald's second law. Excitation is stronger than inhibition. Now let me just tell you a little bit more about this. So when the hair cells at a resting phase are discharging a certain amount, suppose 100 spikes per second, when depolarization occurs, there can be quite a big increase in the outputs, up to even 400 spikes per second. But when there is a hyperpolarization, an inhibition cannot go below zero. So you can see the differential of excitation to inhibition is a big number. And hence, excitation is always a stronger response than the inhibition of hyperpolarization. Now, if I were to move my head to the right, the labyrinth would also move to the right, but the endolymph within the labyrinth, because of inertia, lags behind. So it can be said that when there is a movement to the right, there is a relative movement of the endolymph to the left. This is really important when we'll be talking about physiology. Now, Ewald's first law says that stimulation occurs in the plane of the canal. So we have our three semicircular canals. Each are oriented in the three planes, the yaw, roll, and the pitch planes. And only when we do the movement of the head in the plane of the canal is the canal actually stimulated. So this concept is very important when we talk about BPPV. The positional tests are aimed at bringing each canal into their plane of movement to be able to stimulate it optimally. Similarly, this movement is also important when Sir will talk about the VHIT or the head impulse test, to be able to move in the direction of the canal. Our canals work as pairs. So the horizontal canals work together. Similarly, the left anterior with right posterior and right anterior and left posterior. So when one canal is stimulated, the other side is inhibited. And that is how we get a maximum input to the nervous system about the position. And you can just take the example of the horizontal canal. So moving to one side causes excitation and to the other side causes inhibition. So both of them are working at the same time. This is an extremely important concept, the principle of orientation of kinocelium within the ampulla. The horizontal canals, if you look closely, you'll see that the kinocelium is towards the utricle. You can see it, the position within the cupula. And while in the vertical canals, whether we talk about the anterior and posterior canals, the kinocelium is placed away from the utricle. This is important for Ewald's third law, which states that in the horizontal canal, movement towards the utricle is excitatory, while movement away from the utricle is inhibitory. So when the endolymph moves towards the cupula or the ampulla, we call it ampullopetal movement, that is excitatory, while movement away from the ampulla or ampullofugal movement, you can see, is red, inhibitory stimulation. And for the vertical canals, it's the reverse. So movement of the endolymph towards the ampulla is an inhibitory response, while movement away is the excitatory response. And this is because of the orientation of the kinocelium, and that is how Ewald's third law could be explained. Let us now come to the superstar of our balance system, the vestibulo-ocular reflex. This is responsible for stabilization of the image on the fovea during head movement. And this is responsible for providing equal and opposite movement of the eyes with respect to the head movement. When there is a problem of the VOR, the patient will have difficulty in focusing, a feeling of bobbing of images, or what we call oscillopsia. Now let us take some comparative examples. When there is a visual stimulus, it takes about 20 to 40 milliseconds to reach the brain. But the reaction time, that means from the sensor to the effector, is about 190 milliseconds. An auditory stimulus takes about 10 milliseconds to reach the brain, but the reaction time for a person to respond to that auditory stimulus or to the sound is about 160 milliseconds. And now compare that with the super fast VOR, which takes only 7 milliseconds from sensor to effector. And this is why this reflex provides speed to our balance system and to provide stability to the body. This is because the speed is because it is just a 3-neuron reflex. And if there is a deficit here, the patient needs to slow down all the functions. Basically, the speed gets reduced and the patient actually feels older. They'll feel like overnight, like they've aged a decade. Let us talk about the pathway of the VOR, the vestibulo-ocular reflex. So I'm sort of broken up the pathway for easy understanding. So if there is movement of the head to the right side, you can see at the bottom of the slide that there is depolarization of the right labyrinth. The vestibular nerve sends its impulses to the vestibular nucleus, basically primarily to the medial vestibular nucleus. This sends its output to the sixth cranial nerve, and the sixth cranial nerve then gets the left lateral rectus to contract. From the sixth nucleus, also an interneuron goes to the opposite side, cranial nerve 3 nucleus, and to go on to the right medial rectus and cause its contraction. So you can see now, because of depolarization of the right labyrinth, there is a contraction of right medial rectus and left lateral rectus to pull the eyes to the left side. Now let us talk about the inhibitory pathway. So when the head moves to the right, there is hyperpolarization of the left labyrinth, and the pathway is basically a mirror image of what I just described in the excitatory, but the difference is that it is an inhibitory pathway and hence it causes the muscles to relax. So here you'll see the left lateral rectus and the right lateral rectus and the left medial rectus basically now relax. And when I put both of them together, you can see that there is an increased movement on the eyes basically move to the left when the head turns to the right. What happens when there is a deficit of the left peripheral labyrinth, of the labyrinth? So basically, even at rest, both of these labyrinths are sending a resting tone to the vestibular nucleus, and then this helps in keeping the eyes steady. When there is a deficit or a damage to the left labyrinth, that pathway will stop functioning. And here you can see, because of that, there will be an unopposed action of the healthy labyrinth, in this case, the right one. And this causes the eyes to slowly move to the left because of the unopposed action. However, in the acute stage, once the eyes move slowly to the left, a corrective response from the central nervous system, basically the cerebellum, comes into play to jerk, bring the eyes back to the central position. This is called nystagmus. So just to recap, an acute left peripheral vestibulopathy leads to an unopposed action of the right labyrinth and movement of the eyes to the left. The central component comes into play to pull back the eyes to the center, and because nystagmus is named according to the fast component, the result is a right beating nystagmus. Now, a little bit about Alexander's law. This was given in 1912 by Professor Alexander Gus. So he said that the nystagmus is strongest on looking in the direction of the healthy ear. And for us to actually see all of these nystagmus patterns, it's important to remove optic fixation, because the presence of optic fixation reduces the amplitude of nystagmus, and in seeing the eyes in bright light may actually lead to a complete cessation of the nystagmus, and we may miss out a lot of important findings. That's why examination for spontaneous nystagmus with a VNG or a video Frenzel is very important. So when acute peripheral vestibulopathy leads to a right beating nystagmus, if the patient, on looking to the healthy side, that means in this case the right side, nystagmus is present, this is called first degree or grade 1 nystagmus. If on looking center straight ahead, nystagmus is present, it is grade 2. And on looking to the disease side, in this case to the left side, if nystagmus can be detected, it is a grade 3 nystagmus. So what happens when the acute phase is over? And now this is the subacute stage of the vestibulopathy. So because of the CNS compensation coming into play, there is no cessation of the nystagmus. No more nystagmus will be detected. However, these patients will still have instability on head movement because there is still a lag. The VOR is still deficient on that side, which does not allow the eyes to stay steady on the movement. Let us now talk about the otolith organs. The utricle and the saccule have a sensory organ called the macula, which is analogous to the crista ampullaris of the semicircular canals. So they have similar sensory detectors with the hair cells. They have a gelatinous matrix over the hair cells called the otolith membrane. But the thing which is different is that there are calcium carbonate crystals called otoconia, which are lying over that membrane. And movement of the otoconia in response to movements excite the hair cells and result in firing of the ampullary nerves. So you can see that when there is a stimulation, there can be a stimulation on movements, on tilt. So the flexing the head up and down or extending it backwards will produce different results within the otolith organs. And similarly, the tilt reaction. So giving the example of a person standing in the train, and when suddenly the train starts, because of inertia, the person moves backwards, and this causes a stimulation of the otolith in one direction. But when in the moving train suddenly the driver brakes, this causes the person to go forwards, and then the causes an inhibition of the utricular response. And we need to take this into consideration of how the otolith works when we talk about rehabilitation. So when a patient of otolith dysfunction comes to us, we need to work on different kinds of platforms to give tilt reactions. We can work with trampolines or various surfaces to be able to provide that input, that stimulation, to be able to bring about compensation. Now, I'd now like to talk about the frequency range of the canals versus the otolith organs. And I'd like to thank my teacher, Professor Herman Kingma, from whom I've adapted this slide. And here you can see that the otolith organs basically respond to lower frequencies, and this makes them more sensitive to tilts. So if you see the dotted line, it starts from 0 hertz. That means when it's sensitive to gravity or slow movements, while the semicircular canals have a much broader range of action. And this is why we have so many tests which test the function of the semicircular canal. It is important for us to understand that no one test can evaluate each frequency. And this is why we have this whole range of tests, so that we can cover the whole spectrum. Let us now move on to the vestibulospinal tract, which is responsible for postural control. When there is a problem in the vestibulospinal tract, the patient feels unsteady and is at an increased risk of fall. So talking about the pathway, so we talk about the vestibular nucleus once again. So the medial vestibular nucleus predominantly, along with some inputs from the lateral vestibular nucleus, form the medial vestibulospinal tract, which goes to the spinal cord, the cervical spinal cord, to innervate the muscles of the head and neck, to control that movement for maintaining the position of the patient. And fibers from the lateral vestibular nucleus go down to form the lateral vestibulospinal tract, and these work on the extensors or the anti-gravity muscles of the limbs required for postural control. If we talk about the cerebellum and its relation to the vestibular nucleus, it is basically a dual mechanism, in the sense that there is input from the vestibular nucleus to the cerebellum, and from the cerebellum also affects the vestibular nucleus. So it is a sort of a push-pull mechanism. And because of this cerebellar input, the balance and the muscle tone basically is maintained along with motor coordination, motor learning, and basically fine tuning of the muscle actions. So when I put both of these pathways together, you can see that the vestibular nucleus, along with its inputs from the cerebellum, are responsible for control of the movement of the muscles of head and neck, along with the anti-gravity muscles, which are required for the overall control of the posture. Let us talk a little bit more about the connections of the vestibular nucleus. So we've talked about the vestibular nucleus sending its projections down in the form of the vestibulospinal tract, sending projections to the cerebellum and cerebellum back to the vestibular nucleus. The vestibular nucleus through the medial longitudinal fasciculus acting to the cranial nerves 3rd, 4th and 6th. And finally, there are projections to the cerebral cortex, which are of paramount importance. So, now coming back to these four outputs of the vestibular nucleus. So, vestibulospinal is responsible for postural control. The cerebellum is for sharpening of motor control. That means the accuracy of movement, whether it is precision, how each movement is to be controlled. The cranial nerve nuclei are responsible for the vestibulo-ocular reflex and control of the extraocular muscles with eye movements. But finally, the cerebral cortex is responsible for pushing pre-programmed motor patterns to the vestibular nucleus. So the cerebral cortex receives information from all of these tracts about the position, about the posture of the person. And then the cortex then pushes these patterns, which are to be followed by the rest of the body to be able to maintain the balance of the body. So the cerebral cortical projections are of paramount importance to maintain awareness of the vestibular sensations and also to send these pre-programmed motor patterns to the rest of the body to be able to control the posture. Now, let us talk about this. Is this a fall or is this? So it could be if it is unexpected. That means if the brain does not expect this kind of movement, the person is going to struggle to maintain their body posture. But if it is anticipated in this sort of a situation, the person is more in control of the situation and they know exactly how to modify the motor activity, the body positions. And if I superimpose this on a vestibular deficit, so a patient who has a vestibular deficit, the pre-programmed motor patterns of the cerebral cortex will basically be inadequate. Patient will not feel steady enough. However, if on the deficit, the cerebral cortex develops new motor patterns by the way of neuroplasticity, then the patient can become more steady and more stable. And this can be achieved by vestibular rehabilitation. So vestibular rehabilitation needs to be site targeted. It needs to be progressive. According to the deficit, it has to slowly increase the range, the intensity, the speed of movement to be able to allow the cerebral cortex to develop a whole range of neuroplasticity and control the body in all different situations. So thank you so much. So this talk was basically about our journey from the basics of physiology, going towards pathophysiology, and then our clinical presentations and treatment. So thank you so much, and I'd like now Dr. Anirban sir to take this talk forward. Thank you so much.
Thank you madam, and that was an excellent lecture, and we move on to our next part. Dr. Pawan, you want to say anything?
I think we can take the questions in the last.
Okay, okay.
It was such a lucid presentation ma'am has already made. I think no doubts were there. There's still a few questions I do have. We can subject it to that to ma'am later on. Once Anirban sir does it, because we can correlate the both the lectures all together.
Okay. I think so. We move to the next part, and I'm introducing the next on to the next moderator. Second moderator for the day is Dr. Bala Krishnan R, and he is professor of professor in ENT at Kasturba Medical College, Manipal. Sir has been professor and head of department earlier, and he is been examiner at various universities, as also guest faculty at various national and international conferences. Dr. Bala has also won the Guruswami Gold Medal for best paper presentation at annual conference of AOI Karnataka, as also the Dr. Purushottam Gold Medal for best innovations in ENT in annual conference of AOI Karnataka. Over to Dr. Bala. Good evening, Dr. Bala.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's my proud pleasure to introduce Dr. Anirban Biswas. In fact, he does not need any introduction. Everyone knows him. But as a formality, it is necessary for me to introduce him. He's a very popular figure in the field of neurotology, both nationally as well internationally. He runs a dedicated vertigo and deafness clinic at Calcutta. After graduation and post-graduation from Calcutta Medical College in 1981 and 1984 respectively, Dr. Anirban focused more into neuro-otology. He has written various books on various aspects of vertigo and deafness. They're quite popular among the postgraduate students and the practitioners. His practical and problem-based approach is quite appealing. For his extraordinary contribution to
I think Bala sir can switch off his video, then audio would be like, let's do it.
Dr. Anirban?
Yep, I'm here.
Yeah, yeah. Can you start, sir?
Okay.
Flossom Award.
Acha, Dr. Bala.
Yeah. Journals. He was president of AOI from 2010 and 2011. He is also president of the Neurological and Equilibrium Society of India, 1999 to 2001. He was vice president of the International Neurotrophic and Equilibrometric Society, and he was the president of Indian Academy of Otorhinolaryngology and Head and Neck Surgery. He was editor of the Indian Journal of Otolaryngology and Head and Neck Surgery, and he is member of the editorial board of the International Tinnitus Journal, USA. And currently, he is editor of the Annals of Otology and Neurotology, an official journal of Indian Society of Otology. He has authored an interactive software and audio vestibular data management software. He has a lot of contribution to the field of neurotology, and is the right person who is going to talk to us and enlighten us on evaluation of balance disorders. Dr. Anirban, please.
Well, good evening, everybody, and good evening, our coordinators and moderators. First of all, let us go directly into the subject. Definitely, I convey my thanks and regards to the AOI and to the moderators, and we have a galaxy of top people in ENT. I hardly get much of opportunity to interact with the ENT fraternity because my practice is limited to vertigo only, and so that is a problem for me. Anyway, so we start on this topic. The topic that I've been given today is evaluating the balance disorder patient by clinical examination and vestibular investigations. Now, as I had conveyed before, This is a huge topic, a very big topic. I will try to basically limit myself to the clinical examination part as much as is possible. And if I can finish my lecture just as Anita did in a very finite time, I think that would be the best part. Let us see how much we can cover up in this section. So this is my topic today, evaluating the balance disorder patient by clinical examination and vestibular investigations. Let us see how much we can do. Now see, Anita has covered the physiology of maintenance of balance. Just to understand this in a very short way, the maintenance of balance is a function of the central nervous system primarily. The central nervous system collects information about the static and dynamic position of the body in relation to the ground and the surroundings from certain sensors in different parts of the body. Information from these different sensors is integrated in the brain and compared with previously stored experiences. This is the most important part. That means we all of us have a normal vestibular labyrinth, a normal vision, and normal proprioceptors. Information is collected by all of them, but then the next part is more difficult. That means then it is stored in the brain, and as and when required, that information is retrieved from the brain to maintain balance. So this is the most important part of maintenance of balance. Please remember that storing information and retrieving information, that is very important. Then, and on the basis of this, a very precise, coordinated, and accurately timed motor output is generated reflexly that contracts some specified muscles and restores balance. So this is, in short, the entire physiology of how the body's balance is maintained. This is all known to you. I'm not going into this. Now, what do we need to find out? What we need to find out is basically this. Is the balance system serving the functions of gaze stabilization, postural stabilization, and a perfect perception of the visual vertical? Then, are the sensory input systems and the motor output systems of the vestibular system in perfect order structurally and functionally? And also, are the neurological systems in the central nervous system that execute motor activities and the pathways that connect the different structures of this convoluted anatomy, which Anita has just now shown, of the vestibular system, are they in order? So this is all that we need to know. The physiological processes that need to be tested are the vestibular ocular reflex system, the vestibular spinal reflex system, the perception of verticality. We need to know about the cerebellar and extrapyramidal systems, because these are the two systems that actually carry out the motor function of maintaining the body in position and the eyes in the center. So the cerebellum and extrapyramidal systems are extremely important. Then we need to know about the central and peripheral nervous systems. We also need to know about the cognitive and psychic systems, because all of them play a huge role in the maintenance of balance. The perfect functioning of all these systems and the structural and functional integrity of the neural pathways that connect these systems have to be ascertained. So that is our assignment for today. How can we do it? Now, when we are moving our heads, when we are moving about, you will find that we can maintain a fixed vision, the eyes do not move. And also when we are moving about, walking about, then also we can maintain our body's position very well. When we are seeing things, we have to have a perfect vision, which is perfect vision means our perception of verticality has to be proper. If my perception of verticality is not proper, then things will appear tilted to me. And if the things appear tilted to me, my brain knows, no, that is not tilted. So then I get the perception that I am tilted, and then I get a feeling of imbalance. So these are all extremely important things about which we have to know and we have to understand. What do we test? We test the structural integrity of five parts of the vestibular labyrinth. That means the three semicircular canals, the utricle and the saccule. We test the oculomotor system. We test parts of the central nervous system and the neural pathways. What parts of the central nervous system? Basically the cerebellum and the extrapyramidal system and the neural pathways that connect them. And functionally, we also have to know about gaze stabilization, postural stabilization, and the perception of verticality. So this is what that we test. But then there are a lot of things that we do not test and we miss them out. What do we not test? We do not test the cognitive system, including memory. We do not test the psychic system. We do not test the central nervous system comprising of the visual and vestibular cortex, which control the functioning of the balance system and the subcortical centers that perceive the sensation of imbalance. Now, see, you have to understand that there is a huge part played by the psychic and cognitive systems in the maintenance of balance and the way the individual perceives balance. The inputs to the balance system are, as you all know, from the visuals, from the proprioceptive and sense systems. That is all known to you. And these are there for everybody, but different persons will assimilate it and utilize it differently. Now, this depends upon the cognitive skills of the person and not on whether the receptors are working properly or not. In the test that we do, we basically test the receptors. We do not test the cognitive part. And why do we need to test the cognitive part? We need to test it because the vestibular function tests only evaluate the functionality of the receptors and sometimes that of the neural pathways, nothing more. If there are 10 children in a class, all of them will have the same eyesight. But if you give them 2 pages to read and ask them 10 questions, somebody will get 10 upon 10, somebody will get 5 upon 10, somebody will get 3 upon 10, somebody will get 7 upon 10. Why? Because they will not get the same marks, even if their sensors, that means the eyes, are perfect. Why does this happen? This happens because their cognitive powers are different. You, I, and another person will be having the same inputs from the eyes, from the vestibular labyrinth, and from the proprioceptors. But how much you will be able to utilize it, and how much I will be able to utilize it and store in the brain, and later on when a similar situation arises, then how much I will be able to retrieve from my vestibular memory will be different for different persons, and on that, and what does that depend on? That depends upon my cognitive skills, how well I have been able to store in memory and how well I have been able to retrieve from memory. It does not depend upon how good my lateral semicircular canal is or how good my saccule is or how good my cerebellum is. It all depends upon these things. The sensors and these pathways can always be defective, but then defects in them are much lesser than defects over here. Then there's a huge part played by the psychic system. How much we feel this system, how much I feel the imbalance, what impact is it having on my perception is different for different people. There'll be some people who go to an amusement park, pay money and enjoy the head spinning. And some people, when they lie down in bed and they will get a sudden giddiness for 2 seconds, 3 seconds only, it will make them come running to the doctor. Why is it traumatic in some people and why is it a pleasurable sensation in some people? All these things are extreme, give us the sensation of pleasure and how we are doing, and that will be different in different people. So all these things are extremely, extremely important. I would love to dwell on it much further, but then we have other things to cover, so I will not go into the details. But to keep in mind that the psychic system, the cognitive system, the central nervous system, the cortex, these are all very important in our maintenance of balance. This, I believe, he has already covered. Just to summarize it, in a peripheral vestibular damage of the left side, that is in a unilateral peripheral vestibulopathy, in a sudden and uncompensated left vestibulopathy, what happens? The healthy side takes the healthy right side will take the upper hand. There will be a right beating nystagmus. If the patient has a left-sided hypoactivity, what will happen? The right side will take the upper hand. So you'll be getting a tilt towards the left side and a right beating nystagmus. This Anita has explained very well, and there will be a tilt in our perception of verticality, and it will tilt towards the abnormal side. Then slowly, as compensation takes place, these things will again become normal. So that is how the system functions. In central vestibular damage, what happens? Patients usually get an instability and unsteadiness. There's a difficulty in walking without support. There is usually no spinning or rotating sensation except in acute central lesions of the vascular origin involving the brainstem and or the cerebellum, where there is head spinning and a rotatory sensation. Usually, in a central vestibular damage or in a bilateral peripheral vestibulopathy, the patient will not have that head spinning except in those rare cases where there is a stroke in the brainstem or in the cerebellum. So these patients will come to you with instability and unsteadiness. So that is how you understand whether this patient has a central lesion or a bilateral vestibulopathy, or is a severe head spinning, which would indicate a unilateral vestibulopathy. Because before going into the tests and before doing the clinical examination, this amount of knowledge you have to have such that you can proceed with the tests logically. Now, evaluation of a patient in a vertigo or imbalance is done in a three-pronged approach: the history taking, the clinical examination, and the investigations. Now, these are in order of priority. You get 60% of the information from the history taking, about 30-35% from the clinical examination, and about say 5% from the investigations. So if you have been able to do a thorough history taking and proper clinical examination, you should be able to diagnose your patients in a big way. So with this knowledge, let us go into clinical examination and, if time permits, investigations also. Now, clinical tests in balance disorder patients comprise of a thorough examination of the ears, a brief examination of the cranial nerves, especially the 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th and the 10th cranial nerves, brief examination of the neurological system, that is the deep tendon reflexes, Babinski sign, muscle strength, sensory test of the face and limbs, oculomotor test, test of the cerebellum and extrapyramidal systems, and a thorough examination of the balance system. You see, a lot of these things will be common. When I'm testing the cranial nerves, I'm also testing the neurological system. And when I am doing when I'm testing the cranial nerves, I'm also testing the oculomotor part. And so, you see, a lot of these things are in common. And the last part is examination of the balance system. And what is the examination of the balance system? It means test for the eye position and eye movements to assess vestibulo-ocular and oculomotor system, test of the limbs and the trunk to assess the vestibulospinal system, tests for the perception of verticality, and what is most important and what most of you miss is test to assess cerebellar function and the extrapyramidal system. This is extremely, extremely important, because a lot of patients that come to you actually do not have any problems in the vestibular labyrinths or other parts. They have problems in the cerebellum or in the extrapyramidal system or in the cerebral cortex or in the subcortical regions. So that part needs to be tested. Now, we start with the eye movements. It is best seen with Frenzel's glasses. So if you can afford a Frenzel's glasses, especially a video Frenzel's glasses, this part becomes much easier. Now, the test for the eye movements consists of abnormal spontaneous eye movements, abnormal provoked eye movements, and oculomotor tests. You have to know that the eyes are the windows to the vestibular system, and vestibular disorders induce abnormal eye movements. Hence, a thorough evaluation of the eye movement is essential in all balance disorder patients, because the vestibular labyrinths and the cerebellum, the different pathways, the extrapyramidal systems, the cerebellum, they are situated so deep inside the brain that we cannot approach them. It is very difficult to approach them. And we do not have any direct access to them. But then these are all related, connected to the eyes. So if you can test the eyes very thoroughly, then you can have a very good idea about what is happening in the vestibular system. So how do we do it? There are three parts of the test. The first part is look for abnormal spontaneous eye movements, then abnormal provoked eye movements, and the third part is the oculomotor test. Let us go through them one by one. The clinical test in neurotology start with the eye test. See, I will be taking quite a bit of time to explain these tests, but doing the test does not take time. It will take hardly 1 to 1.5 minutes time to do the entire thing. This is all that we do. See, you are putting the eyes like this, moving your fingers in the form of a H, holding the finger over there at some times, and this you are now testing the eye movements for the 3rd, 4th, and 6th cranial nerves. We are doing the gaze test on the right side. Now we are doing the gaze. Now looking for any upbeating nystagmus upwards, looking for any downbeating nystagmus downwards. Then we are doing the vergence test. That means we will explain all these tests as this just to show you that doing the entire thing does not take much time. It takes hardly a couple of minutes or even lesser. So then we do the second test, we do like this. Then we do the, after this we do the head impulse test. In the same session, we also do the head shaking test and test for the corneal reflex. This is all that we do. So when I'm looking over here directly, I'm just looking whether the patient is having any nystagmus in the eyes and also looking for any skew deviation in the eyes. Okay. Now, what are the types of, see, that is all the time that you require to do all these different tests, which we will explain now. But explaining will take time, but the doing the test will hardly take you 1.5 to 2 minutes time, not more than that. So though we will, it may appear to you that these are complex tests, they are actually not. The types of abnormal spontaneous eye movement that we look for is nystagmus, whether it's a horizontal nystagmus, vertical nystagmus, or rotatory nystagmus. Then there are certain abnormal spontaneous eye movements like ocular bobbing, ocular flutter, ocular myoclonus, disconjugate nystagmus, circumduction nystagmus, seesaw nystagmus, periodic alternating nystagmus, and opsoclonus. Now, what is nystagmus? This is one of the different types of abnormal spontaneous eye movement. This is horizontal eye movement beating to the left, left beating nystagmus. This is right beating nystagmus. See the model and also see the picture of the eyes. These are things which you have to be able to recognize in your clinic. This is vertically upbeating nystagmus. This is vertically upbeating nystagmus. Then this is downbeating nystagmus. The eyes are suddenly coming down, slowly going up. Suddenly coming down, slowly going up. This is downbeating nystagmus. We will go into the details of all of them and what do they mean. We will do all of them. Then you can have a clockwise rotatory and a clockwise anti-clockwise motion also. It is difficult to see that. You can see the veins in the eyes, which are not shown over here. By looking at the veins in the eyes, we can understand whether this is a rotatory nystagmus or not. Okay, so these are the different types of nystagmus. Horizontal nystagmus, left beating, right beating, vertical nystagmus, up beating, down beating, and rotatory nystagmus, clockwise or anti-clockwise. If you have a Fresnel's glass, it becomes very easy to see it and find it out. Then what are the different types of special abnormal eye movements? You just see them. This is ocular bobbing. What is ocular bobbing? See, this is just like downbeating nystagmus. Come down, wait for a while, and then come up. In downbeating nystagmus, the eyes will fast come down and slowly go up. But here, it is coming down, but it is taking some time and then goes up. So this is ocular bobbing. See, the eyes are coming down fast, waiting, and then going up. This is ocular bobbing. Then we have ocular flutter. What is ocular flutter? In ocular flutter, this ocular flutter, this is a rare type of abnormal eye movement. And then this is how it looks like. Then you have seesaw nystagmus, see, one eye is going up and one eye is going down. So these things, once you see in the video, you have to remember it. And whenever you find something like this, you will never miss this type of eye movement. Then you have these types of disconjugate eye movement, see. This is divergence nystagmus. The eyes are moving outwards. One eye is abducting, and so it's going fast outwards. Both the eyes, this is disconjugate eye movement. Then this is circumduction nystagmus. The eyes are going round like this. Then this is periodic alternating nystagmus. The eyes will be to the left for some time. Then it will stop. It will pick up speed. Then it will stop for a while, and then it will become a right-beating nystagmus. So left-beating nystagmus will stop for a while, and then it will become right-beating nystagmus. So this is periodic alternating nystagmus. You may not see so much of the disconjugate nystagmus or circumduction nystagmus, but periodic alternating nystagmus is something which you must be able to pick up. So I'm showing it to you again. Left-beating nystagmus, slowly picking up speed, then stopping for a while, and then it is becoming a right-beating nystagmus. So this is called periodic alternating nystagmus. The left-beating nystagmus, then stop, then becomes a right-beating nystagmus. Then we go into the other part of the second part of the vestibulo-ocular test, which are the tests for provoked nystagmus. And this includes a part of the oculomotor tests also. What are these tests? The test for gaze nystagmus, the test for head impulse test, the smooth tracking test, the saccadic test, the vergence test, test for skew and cover test, positional and positioning nystagmus test, the labyrinth and fistula test, the head shaking nystagmus test, and the hyperventilation test. We will rush through all of these things because in the allotted time, I do not know how much time we will be having. See, this is how we do the gaze nystagmus test. We just ask the patient to look to the right and then to the left. And what happens in a normal person, how will you up and down? And so in a normal person, to the gaze to the left, see, when I've taken the eyes to the right side, the eyes are looking to the right. And when I'm taking the eyes to the, and the eyes is fixed over there. So this is normal. There is no nystagmus at all. I will show you later on abnormal gaze nystagmus. See the gaze to the left over here, the eyes have moved to the left when I move my eyes to the left, and the eyes are fixed over there without any nystagmus. Had there been any problem over here in the gaze nystagmus test, I would have known that there, since this is a problem in the horizontal gaze nystagmus test, I would have known that there is a lesion in the upper pons. So you see, these things are so very specific, and I can still specify it further and say that the lesion is in the region of the interstitial nucleus of Cahal or in the PPRF. So this is the amount of precision that we have by which we can diagnose any lesion in the system just on the basis of the clinical test. You do not need the high-tech test for each and everything. And just with these clinical tests, if you do them properly, there is no reason why you will miss anything. Now, this is the head impulse test. How do you do the head impulse test? You ask the patient to look into the eyes, into your nose. You hold the patient's head like this, and we give sudden jerks of about 10 to 15 degrees to the left and right. And that is what we do. Just see this, and we are looking for any saccadic eye movement. That means at the end of the eye movement, whether there is any jump in the eye or not. If there is any jump in the eye on left movement, it means that the left-sided peripheral lesion. If there is a jump on right movement of the eye, of the head, that it would mean that there is a right peripheral vestibular lesion. And these jumps are called saccadic systems. I will explain this thing to you in a little over here. See, in a normal person, you just look at the eyes. This is being shown to you in slow motion. In a normal person, what happens? That when the patient is turning the head, the position of the eyes will not change. The position of the eyes will not move with the head, and the position of the eye will remain fixed to the examiner. See, just see over here. Oh, sorry. See here. The patient is moving the head like this, the eyes are going over there. In pathology, what happens? The eyes are moving with the head, and then at the end, suddenly jumping back. You have to see this once again. See, in a normal person, the eye, as over here, the eyes are moving with the head in pathology and then jumping back. See this again. It is normal, this is what is normal, that the eyes are looking towards it. Here the eyes are moving with the head, and at the end of the head movement, the eyes are jumping back. So this is an if pathological head impulse, see, the eyes are moving with the head towards the left and then suddenly jumping back. So this would mean that there is a left-sided peripheral lesion over here. So this is the importance of the head impulse test. Then we do the smooth tracking test. What is the smooth tracking test? This is how we are doing. Patient is visually asked follow a target moving at 15 to 20 degrees per second, 18 inches in front, horizontally and vertically. Presence of saccades indicate that it is normal. What would you get in a normal person? It would be something like this. See, when you are doing it in a normal person, the eyes are moving with the target. Target is my index finger. See, it is moving like this. Had this been abnormal, then what would have happened? The eyes would have moved like this. See, this is a choppy movement of the eyes. This is a saccadic eye movement. That means the patient has got an abnormality in this smooth tracking system. Let me show this to you over here. See, this is what is normal. This is normal. The eyes are moving with the target. This is normal. What happens if it is abnormal? If it is saccadic, then the eyes will move like this in a choppy manner. You have to do this test and find out that whether it is there or not. And these are extremely, extremely easy to find out. And these, all of these things can be done clinically. You don't require all those high-tech things to identify them. Then, you see, this is the saccadic test. This is the fourth test in the list of tests for provoked nystagmus. Horizontal saccades and vertical saccades. We look for whether there is any slow movement or not, whether there is any disconjugate movement, whether there is any incomplete movement, or there is any hypo or hypermetric movement. I will just show you what a normal thing looks like. See this video over here, then you will know what the normal saccadic test, horizontal saccade, looks like. I'll show you the abnormalities later on. See, when I'm doing this, the patient's eye is suddenly jerking, coming to a point and fixing over there. Now, if this is slow, then it would mean that there is a lag over there. There can be a nystagmus at the end. It can happen that one eye is moving and the other eye, after a period, has become stopped. That would be mean a internuclear ophthalmoplegia. So, by doing the saccade test, you can identify so many things. And if the saccadic system is abnormal, if the horizontal saccade is abnormal, it would mean that there is a upper pons lesion. If the vertical saccade is abnormal, it would mean that there is a midbrain lesion. So, you see, these are extremely easy things which you can do in your clinic and identify each of the abnormalities. Then vertical stress. How do we do it? We ask the patient to look straight ahead, and then we, as the thing is coming near, the eyes are coming. As the target is coming nearer, the patient's eyes are coming nearer. So it indicates in a normal response, there'll be a near vision triad, which consists of three things. Eyes will converge towards the midline. There will be accommodation of a near vision and pupillary. But the eyes converging towards the midline, you can see. And pupillary construction also you can see. Accommodation for near vision means the lens becomes thicker. That you cannot see clinically. But whether the eyes, both eyes are converging towards the midline or not, that you can very well see. And the pupillary constriction also you can see. See, this is how this thing is done. As the thing is coming near, the eyes are coming towards the midline. That is all that you need to see. If there is if absence of any one of them is there, it indicates that there is a disorder in the Virgin system. Yeah, see, the positional test, all of you know, I don't think that I need to go into the details of the positional test. You have to do all the positional tests. I'm not showing the video because it will take a pretty long time. You can do these things. Yeah. And this, so this is, you know, then we do the fistula test. Nothing much to show you. See, the point is that you have to do each and every test. That is what is important. By the fistula test, you can definitely identify whether there is a superior semicircular current dehiscence or not. You can pick up any third window syndrome. You can pick up any limb fistula, but patients do well. But any superior semicircular canal dehiscence can be easily picked up by the fistula test. If you find that yes, there is some nystagmus happening, then you ask the patient to have a audiometry done and find out whether there is any small airborne gap in the low frequencies. Then you do a high resolution CT scan of the semicircular canals to find out whether there is any dehiscence or not. And then on the basis of it, you do the requisite surgical treatment. This is the head shaking test. This is what we do for the head shaking test. We do it like this and we see whether there is any nystagmus that is being, we do this and we find out whether there is any nystagmus that is being generated or not. Patient is asked to keep the eyes closed and head shaken for 20 times side to side. Patient is then immediately asked to open the eyes and look for any left beating nystagmus, suggests a right peripheral vestibular lesion, and a right beating nystagmus suggests a left peripheral vestibular lesion. If on doing this you get a vertical lesion, or if the horizontal nystagmus, that means the left beating nystagmus, suddenly becomes right beating, it would indicate that there is a central lesion. So this is the head shaking nystagmus test. Then we do the test for heterotopia, that is the cover test. What is the cover test? We ask the patient to fix the eyes at a distant target, 20 feet, about 20 feet away. One eye is covered and any eye movement or any other or any jump of the other eye is looked for. See, this is exactly what we do. See, patient is looking straight ahead over there and then you cover one eye and you find if on covering one eye is jumping up or down, it means that the patient has got a abnormality. It is called heterotopia, which means that there is a misalignment in the visual axis. It usually indicates a central lesion. Rarely, in severe forms of a peripheral vestibulopathy, also it can be there. But it is usually indicates a central lesion, because if the pathway from the vertical canals to the supranuclear to the nuclei of the eye of the nerves are of the oculomotor centers are interrupted, then you get a misalignment of the visual axis and then this becomes positive. One test that all of you have to do is the Hinz test. This is specially required in a patient who has come to you with sudden onset of severe vertigo. Any patient coming to you with sudden onset of severe vertigo, it is called an acute vestibular syndrome, and it can be either due to a sudden onset of vestibular neuritis, or it can be a stroke in the cerebellum or in the brainstem region. And so you do this test. This is the Hinz test. It consists of three tests. You do the head impulse test. If there is the head impulse is normal, that means you are getting no saccadic movement of the eyes, it would indicate that it is a central lesion, because had it been a peripheral lesion, that means had it been a vestibular neuritis, then the head impulse test would have been positive. Then you do the gaze test like this. You ask the patient to look towards the left side. The red line is the target and you find that there is a left beating nystagmus. But when the patient is looking to the right, we are getting a right beating nystagmus. If there is a direction changing gaze nystagmus, it indicates that there is a central lesion. That means this is possibly a stroke. Then you do the test of skew. What is skew deviation? This is something which all of you have to find out whenever the patient is coming and sitting at you, and when you're looking at the patient's eyes, you have to find out whether both the eyes are at the same level or one eye is above the other eye. How do you know that? If the white sclera beneath the cornea is more on one side, you would know that this patient has got a skew deviation. Then you think that there is a central lesion and you do all the other tests for it. See, what is skew what is skew deviation? Let's see here. normally both eyes are at the same level. What happens in skew deviation is that one eye is at a higher level and the fellow eye is at the normal position. If you cover up this eye by the cover test, that eye will jump down. So this is known as the test for skew deviation. This is normal. And if you find that the patient has come to you with one eye slightly higher than the other eye, you know that this is skew deviation. Then immediately you do the cover test and you find that whether the eye is jumping up or not. Then you know that this patient has got, this test of skew is positive. Then you do the OTR test. What is the OTR test? We'll come to that later on. This is the OTR test. This is skew deviation, which I have already seen. And in this patient who is having skew deviation, usually there will be a head tilt also. A normal patient would be sitting to in front of you like this. But if the patient is sitting to you with the head tilted towards one side, it means that the patient possibly has a ocular tilt reaction. And in these patients, you should specifically do this test for skew deviation and see if there is any abnormality over there or not. And it consists of three things. That means skew deviation will be there. There will be a head tilt. And also there will be a cyclotorsion of the eye. Cyclotorsion of the eye is difficult to find out without an ophthalmoscope. So that part we don't do. We only see whether there is skew deviation or not and whether there is any head tilt or not. So these are the 10 tests that we do to find out provoked nystagmus. Okay. Now, VOR may be jeopardized, but let me see how much time do I have. By the way, Dr. Bala, how much time do I have? Do I have about 10 minutes more?
About 20 minutes.
I have 20 minutes more. Oh, so yeah, that means I can go on till midnight.
8:17 now.
Okay. The count starts now. Okay. So VOR may be jeopardized by defects in the oculomotor system. There can be an ocular misalignment or skew. There can be a defective smooth pursuit. There can be a defect in the saccadic system. There can be disorders in the convergence-divergence system. There can be defect in the optokinetic system, which I have not shown you. Because if you have done this saccadic test and the smooth pursuit test, you do not need to do the optokinetic test in each and every patient. And you also have to test for the defective VOR or the VORS. See, the point of my telling you so much, and I know that this portion is a little boring for everybody, all these clinical tests and all. But the point is, if you are competent in doing each and every clinical test properly, you practically do not require anything else at all. I have been to all the renowned neurologists, all of them who practice in vertigo, not only in India, to different neurological centers throughout the world. Everywhere what I find is that most of these people, they do not depend on these high-tech investigations. Get it from me. They do not depend so much on these high-tech investigations. They only do these clinical tests properly, and in a very few patients, they ask for these high-tech investigations. All of you have a sense and a perception that without these high-tech investigations and high-tech instruments, you cannot diagnose vertigo. It is nowhere like that. If you are capable of doing these clinical tests properly, and these are not difficult, it does not take you more than 2-3 minutes. My explaining to you and showing you these different tests, showing you the videos is taking some amount of time. I'm sorry for that. But then doing the test does not take time at all. I will show you some videos now by which you'll be able to recognize these abnormalities fast. But please, for heaven's sake, whenever this patient of vertigo come to you, please do all these tests, look for abnormal eye movements, do all the tests for provoked nystagmus, for provoked abnormal eye movements, and tests for cerebellar problems and extrapyramidal problems. Let us come to them. See, the abnormal eye movements are all topographic in nature. So just by diagnosing, looking at the eye movement, you can diagnose which part of the brain has been involved, and you don't require anything more. See, in the midbrain, if there is an abnormality in the midbrain, there will be abnormalities in the vertical saccades and in vertical gaze holding. That means the gaze holding test will be abnormal and vertical saccades will be abnormal. If there is a defect in the pons or medulla, the horizontal saccades will be abnormal and horizontal gaze holding will be abnormal. If there is a defect in the cerebellum, then the saccade and smooth, they'll, in the smooth pursuit, there will be saccadic smooth pursuit, which would indicate that there is a lesion in the flocculus or parafloculus. You will be getting downbeating nystagmus. If there is a defect in the flocculus or parafloculus, you will be getting an impaired visual fixation. What is visual fixation? I'll show you right now. And you will be getting an impaired viewer. The vertical and torsional eye movements are controlled in the midbrain and horizontal eye movement in the pons. So if you find that there is an abnormality in the vertical eye movements, you know that the lesion is in the middle. And if you find that there is any problem in the horizontal eye movements, rest assured that the problem is lying in the pons. So that is all. And then you ask for a radiography of these things. Now, these are the different types of eye movements which you have a website. You can find these videos there. You can run it over and over again, and you have to internalize this so that whenever you see something like this, you can immediately diagnose. So flocculus and parafloculus lesions, they will show these things. See, there's a downbeating nystagmus. This you can easily make out. You will never miss a downbeating nystagmus if you see anything like this. See, this red thing is the target. That means my index finger. This is downbeating nystagmus. What is gaze evoked nystagmus? Let me first show you gaze evoked nystagmus, then I'll show you rebound nystagmus. What is gaze evoked nystagmus? That means when my index finger or the target is to the right, I'm getting a right beating nystagmus. And when the target is to the left, I'm getting a left beating nystagmus. This is abnormal gaze nystagmus. What is rebound nystagmus? After the gaze evoked nystagmus, when you ask the patient to look in the middle, if you get a nystagmus in the opposite direction, it would mean a rebound nystagmus. See here. Now, the patient is looking to the right and getting a right beating nystagmus. After this, when I have asked the patient to look in at the middle, patient is getting a left beating nystagmus. So this is called a rebound nystagmus. All these things indicate a lesion in the flocculus or parafloculus. If there is a pathological smooth pursuit, you have seen what a normal smooth pursuit is, and you see a pathological smooth pursuit, the movement would be choppy. See, when I am moving the target like this, the eyes are moving in a staggered fashion. It is not moving smoothly. So this is a pathological smooth pursuit. If you do the smooth pursuit test, and if there is any pathology over there, you can easily pick it up. Then this is poor viewer suppression. When I am moving my head to the understand one thing. When I am moving my head to the left, or I am moving my head to the right, when I am moving my head, then I am stimulating my vestibular labyrinth. I am stimulating the lateral semicircular canal. So when I am stimulating my lateral semicircular canal, when I am moving my head like this, then I should get a nystagmus. And when I am moving my head like this, this labyrinth is being stimulated and this is being inhibited. So I should get a nystagmus. And we do get a nystagmus. Why? If you close your eyes and you move the eyes, your head like this, you will find that you can feel in the pulp of your finger you are getting a nystagmus. But in the normal situation, when my eyes are open and when I move my eyes like this, my head like this, I don't get a nystagmus because there's something called visual suppression, which suppresses that nystagmus. Otherwise, whenever we would have moved our head, we would have in a giddy. That does not happen. But if this function is destroyed, then you get a poor viewer suppression, which is an abnormality. Let us see what a poor viewer suppression is. This is what a poor viewer. See, the patient is looking towards the right, is turning their head towards the right, there was no nystagmus. But when the patient is turning towards the left, the patient is getting a nystagmus, which means that on the left side, the patient is having a poor suppression of the viewer. Viewer is now being suppressed. Though the patient is moving the head to the right, there is no nystagmus. So this is normal. But when the patient is looking to the left, the patient is getting nystagmus. With the eyes open, this should not have happened, because in a normal person, the viewer is supposed to be suppressed with the eyes open. But if that is not suppressed, it is an abnormality, and it indicates different types of things by which you know that there is a lesion in the flocculus parafloculus region. And then dorsal vermis lesion, you'll be getting hypermetric when you're doing the Sackett tests. You see, when in the Sackett test, what do you do? We ask the patient to look to the left and to the right. We go on doing this. And when you're doing the Sackett test, if you find that hypometric Sackett means this, it is like this. If you ask the patient, look, the eyes have come over here but have not been able to come.
Sir,
has crossed it. Hypermetric Sackett. What happens? The hypermetric Sackett. Okay.
Breaking somewhere. What you can do is.
Achha, now
you of your video yourself.
Achha, how do I do that? Okay, let me try to. But if I switch up my video, will the ear not go away? Will my screen not go away? Screen will be there if I switch up my video. Well, I don't think I've been able to switch off the video right now. I do not know.
I'll do it.
Anyway, let us see. Is the voice okay? You do it from your side, okay? So this indicates a dorsal vermis lesion, and that indicates a caudal vestigial nucleus lesion. These are hypometric. Now, nodulus and ventral uvula lesions, they will show you periodic alternating nystagmus, which you have already seen. This is a left beating nystagmus, which is happening. It will stop after a while and then it will become right beating. So if that is there, you know that there is a lesion in the nodulus or in the ventral uvula lesion. So this is periodic alternating nystagmus. And when you do the Dick-Solpike test, you'll be getting all features of a central positional vertigo, which I'm not going into details. You know that what is a central positional vertigo. We are not going into that. So the eye signs in a cerebellar lesion. See, these are the different types of eye signs in a cerebellar lesion. I'll just show it to you once in total. Just see this. There's in gaze nystagmus, there'll be abnormal gaze nystagmus. The patient is looking to the left, getting a left beating nystagmus. When the patient is looking to the right, there's a right beating nystagmus. In smooth pursuit, there'll be a saccadic, choppy eye movement. All of these you must be able to pick up in your clinic, and we do pick up each and every patient like this. Downbeating nystagmus. All these indicate that there is a cerebellar lesion. Then this is rebound nystagmus. You have seen what a nystagmus is. On right gaze, there is a right beating nystagmus. When the patient is looking to the left to the center, then it becomes a left beating nystagmus. Hypometria, you have seen the patient, as the patient look the second, it has not gone in one go, it has taken twice. See? It has stopped here and then gone. I am showing this to you in slightly slow motion. This is a hypometria. What will happen in hypermetria? It will overshoot and then come back. This is hypermetria. Okay, so these are all eye signs. So in downbeating nystagmus, you find a downbeating nystagmus. Then if you find it getting something like this, it will increase on down gaze and on side gaze, and when you make the patient lie down supine. It is common in patients with posture and gait disorder. What does that mean? You find that the patient has got a gait disorder, you must look for downbeating nystagmus. It is caused by bilateral defect of the cerebellar trochlus. Differential diagnosis of downbeating nystagmus, it can be cerebellar degeneration, cerebellar atrophy, Arnold Chiari malformation, cerebellar ischemia or CVA, tumors, meningioma, hemangioma, spinocerebellar degeneration, multiple sclerosis, cerebellitis, platybasia or paraneoplastic syndrome. So what do you do in this patient? You have found a downbeating nystagmus, ask for an MRI and ask for a neurological consultation, but you mention that these are the things that you are suspecting. That means the neurologist who sees your patient knows that I have got to learn my neurology from my ENT colleague. That is the impression that you should give to your neurology colleagues. Because these parts, not most neurologists also do. With all due respect to all neurologists, I am telling you, many a time we get a lot of these patients who have gone to the neurologist, they have not picked it up. When the patient has come to us, we have done all these tests thoroughly in that 2 to 3 minutes time, and we have been able to pick up a lot of these. And then when we find that, yes, this is a problem, then we send it back and understand that this is there. Upbeating nystagmus is very rare, so we are not going into details of that. What is internuclear ophthalmoplegia? This is internuclear ophthalmoplegia. See, when the eyes are moving to left eye is not adducting, impaired adduction. That means there is a defect in the medial longitudinal fasciculus of the left side. This is internuclear ophthalmoplegia. When the eyes are moving to the right, but when the eyes are moving to the left, both eyes are moving. But when the eyes move to the right, the left eye did not adduct properly. See, it is adducting very well. Now, just see, it is adducting so well. But when the patient is looking to the right, the left eye is not going to the right side. So that means this is internuclear ophthalmoplegia of the left side. Now, the downbeating nystagmus indicates lesion in the proculus, upbeating nystagmus. You have seen that, so we are not going to that. Hypermetric saccades, hypometric saccades, impaired vertical saccade, you have seen all these things. Impaired horizontal saccade, this is what is an impaired horizontal saccade. See, when the patient, I have asked the patient to look toward the right side, suddenly it should have gone there, but it eyes underwent a choppy movement and then a nystagmus started on that. That means this is an impaired horizontal saccade. What would an impaired horizontal saccade mean? That means there is a lesion in the pons. There is an impaired vertical saccade. It would mean that, you see, when the patient is looking up, there is a gaze disorder, vertical gaze disorder. What does that mean? There is a lesion in the midbrain region. So you see, it is very easy to find out these things and you will never miss them. Convergence saccade, it means if you get something like this, convergence retraction nystagmus, it would mean that there is a lesion in the posterior commissure of the midbrain. See, these are so easy to find out that if you do this test, you will not miss any one of them. And don't think that your neurologist friends are going to pick them up for you. It is you as the neurologist who has to pick these things up. Now, we talked about eye test for eye movement to assess vestibular ocular reflex, the vestibular spinal reflex, and to assess perception of verticality. We are left to finish this portion, the Unterberger stepping test, and for the cerebellar test, the Healy test, finger nose test, and the rapidly alternating task test. See, in the standing test, what do? We ask the patient to stand on both eyes, on both legs together, eye closed, and then after that, we ask the patient to try and stand on one leg. If the patient can stand on one leg, and if you're doing this on a foam pad, know that there is nothing, the patient does not have any abnormality in the vestibular system at all. So this is an easy test to do. Then this Romberg stepping test, all of you know. The Unterberger stepping test also, I'm not going into the details. We are just skipping through. You know this, that you look for rotational deviation and any side to side sore. The patient is rotating to the left, it means that there is a left peripheral lesion. And if the patient sways too much, then it would mean that side to side sway is increased. It would mean that there is a central lesion. If the patient sways too much, these are things all of you know very well, and we are not going. The patient is walking with a wide base gait. These are the cerebellar tests. This is extremely important that when the patient comes to you, you have to do the finger nose test, the Healy test, and the rapidly alternating task test. We have to check for speech. That means the slurred staccato speech. If it is there, is something that you have to find out in each and every patient that comes to you. You have to see the patient's speech to see whether the patient is unstable or not, tandem walking with the eyes closed. So these are all the things that you do. Finger nose test, all of you know very well. If the patient cannot do it well, then you know that this is a cerebellar disorder. And if the patient
in
I think we lost some connection with sir.
There is some problem with
I think this from the net with doctor.
Doctor,
can you call him up?
So can we go ahead with the questions meanwhile?
Ha, no, I right. Think am I back?
Yeah, you are back, sir. Back.
Achha, good. So I start share screen.
Yeah.
Okay, a little bit more is left. Let me just finish it from here. See, this is where we are. See, the patient will have a wide base gaze. So from all of this, you have to understand. Now, how can you diagnose from this? If the patient has a limb ataxia, it would mean, that means the hands and feet are ataxic. It would mean that the patient has a damage in the peripheral parts of the cerebellum. In central parts of the cerebellum, there will be truncal ataxia. So these are things which you can easily find out. Smooth pursuit test, Sackett test, we have discussed these things, so we are not going into the details. So this is the rebound test, this is the iodokinesia test, the tandem walking test. The tandem walking test is a very good test by which you can find out whether the patient has got any ataxia or not. If the patient can do this thing with the eyes closed properly, you know that the patient does not have any ataxia at all. So this is a slightest ataxia will be brought out by this tandem walking test. Then the cerebellar signs are these things you do. If there is any intention tremor like this, that would mean that there is a cerebellar problem. If there is any this is the past pointing test. If there is undershoot or overshoot, these are the things that you have to do. Intention tremor, slurred speech. Then we do this knee jerk. In a cerebellar patient, there will be a pendular knee jerk. When you have done this, the legs will go on dangling like a pendulum. This is the hypotonia of that. So gaze test, this you have all seen. I am not going into the details. Which part of the cerebellum shows which type of problem, this is there and you can show it. This is how we do the viewer test in the clinic. You have seen this. Last part is the test for the extrapyramidal disorders. When the patient comes to you, you have to find out whether there is any extrapyramidal disorder or not. There are two ways. General inspection is hypomimia, that means reduced facial expression, a dull face. Stooped posture, the patient is bent forwards. Then you'd find out whether there is any resting tremor. If the patient has got any resting tremor, that means when the patient is sitting in front of you, the patient is rolling the finger. It's like the patient has got a slow in a cerebellar problem, you'll get a staccato speech. And what is a staccato speech? A staccato speech is something like this. If you ask the patient to say British Constitution, patient will say British Constitution. That is staccato speech. Donald Duck speech would be speak with brisk saying this. These are taking time, but doing the test will not take time. So these are these different types of tests that you do. Then we do another test called the pull test. We stand behind the patient and pull the patient has got an extrapyramidal disorder. then the patient will fall backwards by more than 3 steps. Normal person will just fall behind by 1 or 2 steps. But if you pull the patient backwards, it is called the pull test. If it is more than 3 steps, it would indicate that there is a extrapyramidal disorder. You look at the patient's gait, if there is hesitancy, difficulty in initiating movement, short shuffling steps, if the patient speeds up as they walk, if there is a reduced arm swing, turning, end block, then all this would mean that there is extrapyramidal disorder. So then if the patient, this is the typical patient, a lot of patients will come to you like this. This is a advanced patient, but with no arm movement. If you make the patient walk, you have to find out whether there is any arm swing. You will call the patient from behind. If the patient just turning, so these are the basic things that you do. Now, the for the perception of visual vertical, in our clinic, you can have the bucket test, or if you have the subjective visual vertical, which does not cost much, you can do this thing and test for the patient's visual vertical. So that consists of everything. The other tests that we do are dizziness simulation tests, battery test for orthostatic hypotension, means we make the patient lie down, measure blood pressure, make the patient stand up and measure blood pressure. There should not be a fall of systolic blood pressure by more than 20 or diastolic blood pressure by more than 10. Then we make the patient lie down, stimulate the carotid sinus region and check for any syncopal attack or not. Hyperventilation is another test that we do for this. So basically this finishes all the tests. And the brief list of clinical in a balanced disorder patient is a brief neurological examination of the cranial nerve, third, fourth and plantar response, motor and sensory, the upper and lower limbs, look for any tremor, ataxia, abnormal head movements, oculomotor test, you have to do the smooth tacking, Sackett test and the gaze holding test, of the vestibular spinal test, you have to do the standing test, stepping test, cerebellar test and the pull test. Of the vestibular ocular test, you have to do this test for spontaneous nystagmus and other abnormal eye movements, head impulse test, test for skew deviation, the cover test, positional and positioning test, and the head shaking test. So this should complete the entire range of tests. Sometimes you will be called to patient the examine the patient at the bedside. For the bedside test, these are the tests that you have to do. Head position test, look for any abnormal head tilt. Eye position test, look for any skew deviation of the eyes. Look for any nystagmus or any abnormal eye movements. Do the head impulse test, do the Sackett test, gaze holding test, smooth tracking test, viewer suppression test, and the basic neurological test. These are the tests that you can do at the patient's bedside. If the patient, you have been called to see the patient at the bedside. And the minimum test in a busy clinic that you need to do for any patient are only these 6 tests. Head impulse test, test for any nystagmus or abnormal eye movement, rhombus test or standing test, and if possible, also do this subjective visual vertical test, that is the Burkitt test. So this is all that you need to know about this. If a very thorough history taking and a detailed clinical examination is done, a proper diagnosis is possible in 85 to 90% of the disciplinary patients, if not more. The sophisticated neurological investigations like VNG, VHIT, VEM, CCG, SVV, DVA, posturography, and imaging is necessary in only about 10 to 15% patients. And for confirming the clinical findings and documenting the extent of morbidity. But if you have done the clinical tests properly, you actually can be able to diagnose everything. So the details of this clinical test for evaluating vestibular function is there in the form of a booklet, which you can download from my website, verticoclinic.in. So enough of clinical testing. The same things in a bit more sophisticated way and a more documented way can be done by the vestibular function tests. the investigation of vestibular function. There are different tests. We are not going into the details of them, but this is just to tell you, for each and every part of the balance system, we have got different tests. Like for the saccule, we do the CFM. For the utricle, we can test the function of the utricle by OFM and subjective visual vertical. We can test the superior semicircular canal by the VHIT, lateral canal in high frequencies by VHIT, in the low frequencies by the caloric test, posterior canal by the VHIT. By combining these, you can find out whether there's an elision in the superior vestibular nerve or in the inferior vestibular nerve. So these are the different vestibular function tests. And in your clinic, if you have a full-fledged vertigo clinic, then you can have the facilities for all these tests. But if you just want to see your patients of vertigo, just the clinical tests should suffice. So these are for each and every part of the balance system, we have got different tests. For, like this is just to tell you what tests we have for each and every part. The oculomotor, so the subjective visual, but so each and everything you can test very accurately and document them. But remember that whatever be the test, there is nothing to beat a thorough history taking, a proper clinical examination, and the clinician's clinical judgment. All vestibulometric tests are only as good as the man behind the machine and the clinician interpreting the test. This is the most important thing. If you yourself do not have the time to do the test and supervise the test, do not have third parties do the test for you. It does not work, because until the man behind the machine is very knowledgeable about the test, it will give you a wrong finding and you will get artifacts, and then you make extra meaning for the artifacts and then you pursue the wrong track. Just a report without the detailed history and a thoroughly done clinical test mean nothing. So even if you have all these test facilities, these sophisticated tests, they would not mean anything to you until you have the history and the clinical test findings with you. And if you have to do this test, the test battery approach is essential, and nothing can be approached by a single test. So I believe I finish over here. I've taken a long time, but then as I had begged apology from the very beginning, that this is a very time-consuming thing which had given me. I am sorry I had to rush through a lot of things, but let me tell you, though the presentation took a lot of time, please do believe me that if you do the tests, it will not take you more than 5 to 7 minutes time for the entire test battery. And that I think your vertigo patients do deserve. You just have to know what to see and how to find it out and localize the lesion, and then give the treatment for that or do the requisite imaging studies. Thank you very much. I'll stop the screen share now. Thank you very much. So I took 1 hour and I think 2 minutes. Okay.
So thank you very much, sir, for a very elaborate session on evaluation of patients with balance disorder. And you have really highlighted the need for proper history and clinical assessment than sophisticated tests. We'll try to take some questions, Pawan.
I do have some questions for Anitha, ma'am.
Yeah, sure.
So, one question is there from Dr. Rajesh Jain, who is there in Bhilwara, Rajasthan, that why runners, they lean forward while they are running?
So, basically, it's sort of to make themselves more aerodynamically suitable for an acceleration. So if you give the analog, this example of perhaps the plane. So the way the plane tilts itself so that the pointed part is there forward to provide the least resistance to the air. So that is why it's happening. So it's not that it's increasing the stability, but it is reducing the inertia and allowing the runner to run faster.
Or maybe one more point, maybe, ma'am, the center of gravity, they want to push it forward so that the acceleration in forward direction is easier as compared to the vertical position.
So
the center of gravity also, they are moving.
Center of gravity, so it doesn't. So they say you should not run tall. Don't keep your body erect when you run. You have to bend.
Yes. Yeah. So the second question for you, ma'am, from Santosh Kakkar sir. We are blessed to have Kakkar sir with us. there, and I have seen that Santosh Kakkar sir is there in most of the webinars and he is actively participating. So we are blessed to have him there, sir. Good evening, sir. So does brain work as a whole or each part separately in balance system?
Right. So thank you, sir. I really appreciate your question. So the balance system is basically a sort of a network. So it nothing works in isolation. Everything has its counterparts. It's like a push-pull system. So the counterbalances are in place to make sure that there is a smooth running of the system. So hence, you cannot say that any one part, but if there is a problem in any one part, there are mechanisms to help overcome that deficit and to ensure that the patient is able to maintain their balance or at least recover their balance with time. So I would say it's a sum of parts.
So I think if we compare the hearing mechanism from the balance mechanism do have many parallel pathways going on to recorrect the pathology which is there, that lacuna which is there because of the one station. The other stations, they start adapting to the things and do on. But in hearing, we do not have that system down there. So one more question. So sir, then Bala sir, you can ask other questions.
There are several comments.
I also wanted to
and appreciations to both the speakers, and some of them asked whether these recordings are this talk is recorded or is being put into YouTube.
Yeah, you are talking about Rajan. Rajan from Jacksonville.
A lot of people have asked that.
Yeah, even Rajan from Jacksonville, he has asked whether recording would be available. So it would be available on AOI website. You will have a link at AOI website. It might take maybe a day, maybe a couple of days or a couple of weeks, but each and every presentation would be there. So Santosh Kakkar sir's second question was like, do medicines change according to the change of the site of the pathology? Like if it is some pathology there in semicircular canal or maybe in utricle or saccule, do you have separate medicines for separate parts?
Pavan, should I take the question or is sir?
Yeah, it's for you. Then Bala sir can ask.
Right. Okay. So, sir, I would say that in response to this, it's more of the underlying pathology which is affecting the disorder. So whether you have perhaps a migraine or a menias or a BPPV. So even though each one of them may be affecting similar systems, but because the pathology is different, so whether BPPV being a mechanical disorder of the semicircular canals will have a different treatment protocol as compared to something like a menias, which is also affecting the semicircular canals, of course, with the otoliths. But finally, the basic mechanism will change in our treatment approach. But more important than that is when we talk about deficits, and we talk about rehabilitation, because that is when site of lesion is of prime importance and we need to understand what is the site of lesion for us to help the patient develop the compensatory strategies and to overcome that deficit. So that's it.
Thank you, ma'am.
Excuse me, Pavan, just 1 second. Can I please add a little more to this aspect?
Yes.
Yeah. See, the point is we have to understand certain things. That is, knowing whether my saccule is 39.8% defective or whether my lateral semicircular canal is 57.69% defective does not help.
Yes.
Get it clear? It does not help in the treatment at all.
Okay.
So it does not help in the treatment at all. Get this thing very clear. Then why do we do it? We do it, of course, we need to do it. We do it because there is no medicine which will be able to increase my 57.8% damage and make it 20% damage. Because these cells are special sensory epithelium, and special sensory epithelium is non-mitotic. So we are not regenerating the cells by medicines. Then why do we do the test? We do the test only because if I can know that my saccule of the right side is 35% defective, then if and only if I have a vestibular physiotherapy system by which I can stimulate the saccule, then it makes sense. Just by knowing that my lateral semicircular canal is 57% defective, how does it help in treatment? It does not help in treatment. My 57% deficit on the right lateral semicircular canal can be due to an acoustic neuroma on that side. It can be due to a vestibular neuritis on that side. It can be due to a multiple sclerosis on the nerve. It can be due to any degenerative disorder. It can be due to a Meniere's disease in the hypoactive stage, or it can be due to a hyperactive stage of the Meniere's disease of the other side. So all these things will have different treatment modalities. So knowing whether it is 65% loss or not, it means nothing and absolutely nothing. See, yes. Then why do we do it? As I said again, that is, there are now mechanisms available by which you can specifically stimulate the lateral semicircular canal at a particular range of frequencies. Like if you do test like the FHIT. FHIT is one test by which you can know that my lateral semicircular canal is not behaving well between 3000 Hz to 4000 Hz acceleration. Then in that machine itself, they will be having a mechanism by which you can stimulate the lateral semicircular canal in between those frequencies. How do they have it? They have separate systems in gyroscopes fitted on the head. And then only when you are moving the head at that particular frequency, a letter comes in front of you. And then you know, if you read the letter, then you know that you are moving the head at that particular frequency. And then what happens is, it is not that the cells are getting regenerated. It happens that the remaining part of the system becomes more attuned, and the central nervous system then adapts to the newer system. So third question over here is extremely, extremely, extremely relevant in today's situation, that knowing all these things, do medicine cells? No, they don't. And that is why in all the things that have come out in treatment guidelines, diagnostic guidelines, nowhere will you find that any disease is diagnosed or according to the guidelines, except for bilateral vestibulopathy. No other treatment, be it Meniere's disease, be it vestibular migraine, be it any other disease, they are saying that these test findings will have to be this.
Sir,
they are diagnosed only on clinical tests and history.
Sir, points well taken, sir. It's just like we do the things with the tuning fork to get the hearing loss, type of hearing loss, the intensity, the severity of hearing loss we can make out with the tuning fork itself. But we do have audiometry to make it on the paper to compare and to give a medical legal opinion regarding the things.
Not only that, if you know that you have a deafness between 4000 to 8000 hertz, then we have the technology today by which we can amplify that portion only. So that technology is now also coming in vestibular science. And so we can stimulate that portion also.
Coming there, I think Bala sir has got a lot of questions down there.
Okay, please.
Has asked, any comments about vestibular evaluation during the COVID times? Any special technique that you are utilizing and having to test these patients because of the social distancing you have to follow? Any role of telemedicine or video consultation? How do you really manage evaluating these patients during the COVID times? Dr. Anirban?
Okay. See, now, as what I am doing now is that I am very rarely seeing patients until they are very much necessary. We are doing more of video consultations now. I am 64 will be 65 now. And so my wife is not allowing me to attend the clinic now. Yeah. We have a junior doctor who is running the clinic. All that is there. But at the same day, I am not attending. What I am doing is that I am doing video consultations. And now with these good mobile phones, you can, I ask the patient to put the mobile phone in front of the eyes, make the eyes big, and they see what nystagmus is there and all these things I can make out. And I cannot do a lot of tests on the video, of course. But then you have to do the Hackett test and all these tests. You have to be in 2 feet in front of the patient. And so if you are taking proper measures, and if you are lucky, you may not be affected. But then I believe safety comes of paramount importance. It is your perspective against mine. So a lot of it you can do by hearing the history and by looking at the patient's eyes. Through this, I also make patient walk. I'm at the patient. You do the 10-day walking. You do this. Ask somebody to stand beside you. Do the Romberg's test. And then, do you have any pin rolling movement? Show me your hands. Whether there's any.
So I think that is a good idea to go ahead with. So this question was there from Muthu Kumar from the hospital.
Yeah, from hospital. Yes, yes.
Yeah. So Bala sir, you can go.
I add to this?
One Kumar Ravel from Chennai.
Anita ma'am would like to. Anita ma'am would like to add something in this COVID era, basically.
So, sir, basically during we are at least in my clinic and in several clinics all over, testing is going on. We specifically tell the patient that the mask will not be removed. So not examining the nose and throat, which actually for vertigo patients is not required anyway. So with the shield, looking at the ear, palpating for the head movements and all, and then we are sterilizing our equipment before and after every single patient we're testing. We're changing all the sheets. The chair covers, everything. Patient and their attendant are wearing gloves. So is my staff, every single patient. So these are the precautions we're taking. Yes. Still doing the patients, the workup.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, that is very important. We are also taking all these precautions on the test that we are doing. But you see, if you do evaluate the patient properly, you cannot do it from 6 feet away.
Absolutely.
That is becoming a problem.
Yeah, yeah.
So that is why at my age, I think after 60, we have to be a little careful. Yet then you can definitely get these problems. But yet then I think depending on every situation, we are changing sheets, all these things we are doing. But to do the thing clinically, somebody, me or my assistant, to do the VNG, you are having to breathe the same patient's air nearby, and it is the patient. When you are doing it, you are only 2 feet away from the patient. We have also made a box, a type of box which is transparent, but and we have holes on the side by which we put the hands in, and we can manipulate on these things. But yet, then it is basically a poor man's test.
Yes, yes. So even any other ENT examination, you can't do it from 6 feet.
Yeah.
Absolutely, you have to see the ear and everything. Yeah. So, Bala sir, do you have any more questions there from?
Yeah, Dr. Kumar Ravel from Chennai asked, what is the percentage of patients with vertigo cured in your practice? I think both can answer.
Yes, both of them should answer.
Rather. Yeah. What is the percentage of patients cured from vertigo?
Sir, are you going first, Anirvan sir?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. I can see. In more than 90% of the patients, we give them a better quality of life. Now, your question on what do you mean by cure? If you think that a patient of miniature disease has come to me with a 70% damage of his hearing and a 65% loss of his balance function, if you think cure would mean regenerating those cochlear cells or regenerating the vestibular cells, that is not possible. It cannot happen. But with medication, I can ensure that the patient's number of attacks do come down substantially. With the hearing aid, I can make the patient hear. And so with treatment, we definitely can give the patient a much, much better quality of life. So cure is a very relative term. Exactly. And similarly with a BPPV, when you are doing the maneuver, you are curing the patient, but I am not putting glue into the utricle or into the otolith organs to hold the particles back so that in future it will not occur, because the stickiness of the or the otolith organs are such that particles are loose inside. They have come out today, I have put them in today, then near future it can again come out. So we are very clean and very transparent with our patients. We tell them that this is what is possible. I've been able to do this. I've not been able to put glue. If you want glue to be put in over there, you have to make one trip to heaven and come back, because that is superhuman job. God can do it, not me. So make a trip up, come down. You'll be coming down with a normal labyrinth and with a normal cochlea.
Anita, ma'am.
I think Madam is going to
give it a try. So I agree with a lot of the things which sir has talked about. 90%+ of patients go back with a good outcome, in the sense what they came. Some will, of course, BPPV will respond like magic and on the table. Other patients, like if you talk about vestibulopathies, so when you do the diagnosis, you have to give a time frame to the patient of what kind of your treatment plan. If it's a vestibular migraine, you talk about treatment in months. If you talk about vestibulopathies, like suppose a post vestibular neuritis patient, you need to tell your patients that we will be working with you on rehab for the next 6 weeks and things like that. And then at the end, we also evaluate the outcomes of the patient to make sure that they have the best possible outcome. So I would say yes, 90% plus patients do have good outcomes, very good outcomes.
Yeah, Vibhavri from New Delhi has asked, how do we conduct cognitive and psychiatric assessment of patient in the
yes. open? It's a very important thing. See, in our clinic, we have got a psychologist on a regular basis. The psychologist comes onto our clinic. If you don't have it, and now, like now, we are not affording the psychologist. I'm not being able to pay for the psychologist. So what we have otherwise, and before the psychologist come, we have the questionnaires. There are definite questionnaires available. Like any patient who comes to my clinic, or before the patient comes to the clinic, when the patient has made the appointment, we send a history sheet. The DHI score, all this is filled up before I see the patient. The DHI score, the HADS score, that means the hospital anxiety depression scale is there. These are all questionnaires. Then you have got questionnaires for cognitive assessment. So don't need to have a psychologist also. These questionnaires are available, which can be downloaded free from the net. And you can always make the patient fill up these things. And so when the patient is coming to you, you know that this is the status of the anxiety level, this is the status of this thing. But these things, what is important is that you have to know the cognitive status of the patient. You have to know the You have to know the anxiety depression scale of the patient, because a huge number of these patients, many of them, about textbook teaching is that about 50% of the patients who come to you with vertigo imbalance do not have any disorder in the vestibular labyrinths. They have disorders in these psychic and cognitive systems. Like we do a memory test on the patient also, because now we know that dementia, Alzheimer's disease, is one of the main, a big cause of instability, patients falling, because they, if they have dementia, they cannot store in the memory and retrieve from memory the information from their vestibular memory. So these things are extremely important, and it is very good that whoever has asked this question has put this thing up, because these are, I believe, today much, much more important than having a VNG machine in your clinic. I am never saying that you don't need the VNG machine, you don't need the VHAT machine, you definitely do need them. But with them, you also need these questionnaires. They don't cost you money. They're freely downloadable from the net. So if you have this, have them first, do the clinical tests first, and then have the sophisticated machines. You definitely need it. Please do not at all think that I'm trying to give any signal that you don't need these machines. I'm saying that it is there. But just because you don't have these machines, you cannot practice in vertigo. This is a very wrong signal. That is what I'm wanting to tell everybody.
Sir, there is one more question from Dr. Rajesh Jain from Bilwara. A very interesting question. How do you see nystagmus in blind? Is there any difference in a nystagmus in a blind person? Or do you do differently, or there is some difference in the interpretation in a blind person?
Very difficult to do, because you see, as I said in the very beginning, the eyes are the window to the vestibular system. And if the eyes, you cannot move the eyes, if blindness can be in one eye, then it's possible to test that person thoroughly. The blindness is there in both eyes, and if the third nerve and second nerve has been affected, there is precious little that you can do. You can't do anything, because even if you have to do a VEMP in that patient, you can do a VEMP. That much you can do. But doing a VEMP, does it tell you anything at all? It tells you absolutely nothing. It tells you nothing. You are only testing the saccule by doing the cervical VEMP. The ocular VEMP you cannot do if the patient is absolutely blind, because you will not be able to make the patient look up and all these things. So you can do a cervical VEMP. But in the cervical VEMP, what will you know? You will only know that the saccule is defective. What treatment do you have for that? You don't have any treatment for that other than physiotherapy. So testing a patient who is absolutely blind is actually difficult, and we go by the clinical test, make the patient do the walking and all, see if there is any visible nystagmus or not, because you can't even do the saccade test because the patient is not seeing. How will you do the saccade test?
These patients, the visual input is already lost, so they already have compensated that visual loss.
Yeah.
So in walking, tandem walking and all, they would be doing fine.
Yeah, many of them do, but see, many of them it can be affected. I would like to hear Anita's answer also. If Anita also enlightens us on this, it would be nice. Anita, would you please also enlighten us on examining a blind patient?
Absolutely. Sir, I have an experience with a few cases of macular degeneration and retinitis pigmentosa. Okay. So both of them, these two kinds of patients, so the visual acuity was very low. But the thing is that there's a difference between oculomotor function and visual function. Yeah. So we could still elicit oculomotor functions. That means we could elicit the nystagmus, because that is not affected by the visual fields in these patients. One patient actually turned out to be a BPPV patient. She was some 65 plus. And so even though, so it was the retina which is not functioning, the oculomotor functions, the third, fourth, sixth nerve all working well, and hence we could do the test in these kind of patients. Some blind patients also have spontaneous nystagmus, which we need to be aware of, which is related to the blindness and not to a vestibular or a central disorder. So we need to be aware of that as well. So you'll see that it does not change, that nystagmus is basically, like, it does not really trouble the patient, because that is like what you see even in albinos. You see a sort of a nystagmus, or you see nystagmus in congenital cases. Congenital nystagmus can also be done. So they are able to basically overcome that nystagmus by looking in certain directions and bringing it what we call a null point.
Especially, ma'am, on VNG, I think on VNG you can pick up easily.
Right.
But it is not directly proposed. Associated with that visual fixation or something like that.
Right.
The patient got a bad squint. How do you manage these patients? The gaze and
so for the squint, of course, calibration you need to do before the test is difficult. But if we see clinically that, yes, the ocular movements are restricted in a particular, whether a medial gaze or a lateral gaze, we can still, because overcoming that, understanding that, yes, the saccades and the smooth pursuit can be affected by it, but rest of your VNG tests will be able to do quite smoothly.
Again, Rajesh yes. from Bilwara has asked, can we repeat Dix Hallpeck test after 30 minutes to check the success of the maneuver?
I do it after 2 hours. Make the patient wait for 2 hours and then do it. But I have seen doctors also who are doing it immediately in, say, after making the patient wait for half an hour or 15 minutes also, they do it. See, it depends on person to person, and there is no definite answer, scientific answer for this. Ideally, you should do it after 2 to 3 days. Ideally, but that is also nowhere written. It's basically from what other people tell us, that it takes the particles about a couple of days to settle down over there. So it's best you do not do it before that. But even in many patients who come from outstation, I make them patient do a sit for about a couple of hours, and then I've done the test again and found it to be completely normal. If I find that no, it is again there, then I will not try it again after 2 hours. Then I tell the patient, "Thik hai, abhi hum kar diya hai, go back, come after 2 days." That is how it works.
But you must be instructing them to sit there, not moving around, not doing any other thing.
Basically, I tell them to sit with the head slightly flexed like this, yes. so that they do not put the head backwards. Yes. Other than if in a posterior canal BPP.
Okay.
Other than that, nothing much.
Okay, sir.
Nirmalya Majumdar from Pondicherry has asked, COVID-19 is getting access through olfactory cells into subarachnoid space and CSF. Do you expect in neurotology problems due to COVID?
I would not touch if the COVID is already there. I would try not to touch. But for that, of course, if the patient is complaining of vertigo, without even touching, you have recourse to Vatin and Sugaran, na? So I think without that, it is not proper because that is not life-threatening.
Yes, yes, sir.
So that can wait.
Wait for some time, yes.
Yeah, wait for some time. Come after 14 days.
Dr. Rohan Pandey from Mumbai has asked, sir, in neurological causes, can we prescribe VRT in addition to beta-histine apart from neurological consultation?
What? Repeat the question again.
In neurological cases, can we prescribe VRT, I think vestibular rehabilitation therapy, in addition to beta-histine?
Okay. I would love to answer this question first, and then Anita will also answer this. See, the point is, if the patient is having neurological problem, where does the question of beta-histine come in? The patient is having some neurological problem. There is no question. You treat the neurological problem. If that cures it, fair enough. And why do you want to use the beta histine? Is something which I don't understand. You see, the point, everywhere it is given.
I think empirical.
Even at pretty high doses, it does not act well. Even at high doses in meningitis and not, it does not act. And moreover, see, there is a lot of 2020 studies, means 2020, this year also studies have come out, 2018 also studies have come out, that in human beings, when you are taking beta-histine has got a very high, fast, there's that term for it, fast active state or something, which means that since we have MAO, monoamino oxidase in our GI system, the beta-histine gets destroyed immediately and very fast. That is all there in the studies. There is one of a reference on that by Michael Stroop's article, I think just a 2018 article also there. This thing that it gets destroyed very fast. Why is it that they always show cat studies? Because in cats, the GI system does not have so much of MO of MAO. Monoamino oxidase is not there in the cat stomach, so it stays for some time. But in humans, the MAO destroys the chemical extremely fast. So that's why what they're doing, they're trying to give very high doses, extremely high doses. It can be made to work or something. It is heavily, and that is why it sells a lot, because most doctors don't read. If you read up pharmacology, if you read up all these recent publications on that, everywhere it is given. That term is not coming to mind right now. There's like some fast deactivation rate or something, and so it gets catabolized very fast by MAO, which is there in the GI system of human beings.
Sir, there have been a few papers which suggest that beta-histidine also works at the vestibular nucleus. But the level of evidence is not there. No appropriate level of evidence is there. So you are right, sir.
See, it does not make any sense. Let me also answer your question.
Yes.
That it is there. What has been found? It has not been found that beta-histidine works over there. What has been found is that after a vestibular damage, the medial vestibular nucleus secretes histamine. That is known.
Okay.
But that histamine secretion is not due to beta-histidine. That is a natural process. Like while shaving over here, I can get a nick. It does not mean that I go to a plastic surgeon to stitch it up.
Yeah.
But it will heal up by itself.
Yes.
So that histamine which is released, it's a natural phenomenon. And where do we have the studies which have shown that with the dose of beta-histidine that you are giving, more histamine is being released? And if more histamine is being released, have you ever found out that what is the, there are studies which have shown that excess histamine in the brain, what are the effects of excess histamine in the brain? See, why I am talking so much about these things is that I have just completed writing one chapter on drug therapy of vertigo for my new book. So I have to read a lot of neurochemistry, neuropharmacology, all the recent publications that have been there on drug therapy. Otherwise, I would not have known so much about this MAO and all these things. It is not expected that you know. But when you read up these things, and then
any other question, Bala sir?
Sanjay Helale from Mumbai has asked, what is the therapy for Maldi-Brackmann syndrome?
Oh, Maldi-Brackmann syndrome, the therapy for it is, there is something called Dr. DAI. You just find out treatment for Maldi-Brackmann syndrome. There is a person called Dai in US who has devised a chair in which the chair rotates. It's a revolving chair which rotates, and they make the patient see some optokinetic stimulation. That means there are lines which are passing, and the patient is made to rotate on a chair. And this thing, it is a treatment by DAI is the name. If you Google search it, you can find out it is there. We do get a lot of patients of spontaneous Maldi-Brackmann syndrome. Since we do not have that rotating chair and that optokinetic stimulation we have, but we do not have a rotating chair which can be the rate of which can be changed according to the requirement. That person has got that thing.
Presentation, sir.
So what?
How do they present?
So the patient will come and tell you that I feel that whenever the, what is the hallmark of, how do you recognize this patient? The patient comes with a typical symptom that I feel unstable. You ask him that you feel unstable, but anybody has seen you that you're walking like a drunken sailor? No, sir, it's not like that, but I feel very unstable. Have you ever been to a ship? No, sir, I've not been to a ship. If it is a ship, then it's called Maldi-Brackmann syndrome. If it is not a ship, then you call them, then you tell, it's called spontaneous Maldi-Brackmann syndrome. That means even without the ship, the patient has had it. And the next question that we ask is, to know that this is spontaneous Maldi-Brackmann syndrome, is that we ask the patient that, are you very comfortable when you're in a vehicle? supposing you're in a train or in a car, you're perfectly comfortable in movement. But when you alight from that moving vehicle, you start feeling the instability. Yes, sir, yes, sir. Nobody has asked me this question. This is exactly what I feel. I am very comfortable in a car. So that means it is a, this is the USP, or this is the million-dollar question by which you diagnose that it is a case of spontaneous malady debarment syndrome. They are very comfortable when they are in motion. But when they are not in motion, that time they start feeling the instability. So the treatment for this is what this DAI has got. That is the universally recognized treatment. And that what is this? I don't have it in my clinic because I do not afford a rotating chair. And moreover, with this COVID times, I don't think in the next 5 years I will afford one.
Doctor, I think Dr. Yogesh is a bit, looks like a bit anxious because it is already getting to 9:30.
One last question. Ramesh Royu from Aurangabad is asking any precautions while doing VNG in the COVID era. Do you do it at all, or you take any special precautions for VNG?
Sir, like as I said, we have a cover inside the VNG. We are sanitizing it with alcohol. We have a sort of a nebulizer of alcohol for all the equipment. So before and after every single patient, we are using sterilizing it, and we are able to do the test for all our patients.
But Dr. Ramesh Rohiwal, I would advise you not to do it.
Yeah.
You are already 65.
Okay, you know him.
खुश होके घर में रहो. ये सब अभी करने को time नहीं है. But if you are doing a VNG, you will have to be near the patient, and you will not be able to keep that social distancing of 6 feet. By that, you cannot do a VNG. If you are not touching it, your assistant is touching it. So what you do not want for yourself, please don't force your assistant to do it also.
Yes.
So that I think you should not do it. Okay. One thing that, and VNG is not something which is a life-saving test.
Okay.
So I believe you should not do it now.
Sir, Dr. Charuhas has written has asked a very pertinent question. His comment is very good. Charuhas Jagtap, he does a lot of work in vitiligo from Dhule. That he has observed tinnitus to be the presenting symptom in a few COVID positive patients. And I've also seen two patients who came to me are having tinnitus. And it is acute onset tinnitus. I tried to treat with steroids and everything, not getting. I just flashed, I got a COVID and it is positive. Don't know how do you relate tinnitus to COVID, not yet published, I think. Not is there in the newspapers or maybe the WHO sites or something like that.
Same way as, it is the same way as cervical spondylosis is linked to vertigo.
Yes.
More people have cervical spondylosis, so some of them have vertigo also. That means it does not mean...
So sir, I think you also would agree that it is sort of something like a viral neuronitis.
Maybe, but viral neuronitis not causing deafness, not causing vertigo. Which viral neuronitis do you know has caused tinnitus?
But sir, you would have seen a lot of cases in which acute onset tinnitus is there without any vestibular system.
Yeah, of course. Acute onset tinnitus is there, but yeah, it does not mean that all acute onset tinnitus is due to a viral.
Yeah.
There's nothing like that written, yeah, that acute onset tinnitus is due to viral.
Okay. So I think we already have gone beyond half an hour beyond our allotted time.
Actually, my presentation took a long time. Na? That was what
it was for the benefit of people. We are admiring you and Anita ma'am like anything. There are hundreds of compliments.
Admiring both speakers.
Yeah, hundreds of compliments to you guys. And like, we can't take the name of all these people, but they are admiring like anything. So I think Yogesh boss can make a concluding remark.
If they're still there after 2.5 hours, then we should be admiring them.
Exactly.
It should not be the other way around.
Yes.
That a topic like vertigo, if it can bind down ENT surgeons, then nothing like it. And to Ramesh Rohiwal, again, Ramesh, listen, there are three COVID ENT doctors now admitted in Calcutta. Three COVID ENT doctors now admitted in Calcutta. For heaven's sake, you bloody sit at home. Sorry. For heaven's sake, you please sit at home. Both were. पैंसठ साल बहुत पैसा कमाया अभी छोड़
सर योगेश बॉस
या आई थिंक डॉक्टर अनिर्बन इज राइट वर्टिगो कैन वेट बट इट वाज अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग सेशन एंड टू फिनोमिनली वेरी गुड स्पीकर्स इट वाज लॉट ऑफ पीपल हैव अप्रिशिएटेड टुडे सेशन एंड आई थैंक द स्पीकर्स डॉक्टर अनीता भंडारी एंड डॉक्टर अनिर्बन बिस्वास Also, I thank the moderators for their insightful questions and comments, Dr. Pawan Singhal and Dr. Balakrishnan. And I thank Dr. Reddy's for hosting this AOI webinar series. And I thank all the participants also for
lobbying. And Jogesh, one thing, please give an extra thanks to Dr. Kakkar and Dr. Nirmala Mojumdar.
Yeah.
Both of them are above 85.
Yes.
Yes, so Dr. Nirmala Mojumdar from Pondicherry and Dr. Professor Kakkar sitting through this is something when we feel so enthused by their presence. It gives validity, it gives credibility, and it gives a lot of sanctity to these meetings. Their presence is something when we have followed them like idols, and now to find them participating in this is something very, very great.
And sir, a message to youngsters also that at this age, they are so keen to learn and to discuss the things. Why can't our youngsters just sit down, clear their fundamentals and come up with good ENT consultants there for the Society of India?
I also have an answer to this, Pawan. That is, the youngsters, they are used to pressing the Google thing and finding an answer over there on one press of Google. Which our teachers probably were not used to this. Anyway, I think we need to close down now.
Yeah.
We'll be archiving all the lectures and all these lectures will be on the AOI website. So those who have missed them, they can log in and later on view the lectures.
Thank you.